In this episode on my series on the bones of Unreal, we're covering virtual bones, what they are and how to use them. But it's going to be a fairly technical episode because we're really diving into how they fundamentally behave. If that's your jam, then look no further. Let's dive in. All right, to properly understand virtual bones, it's helpful to first have a basic understanding of IK and additive animations, as virtual bones are often used to solve issues relating to those two, but I won't cover that in detail in this video. Virtual bones are attached to a parent from which their transform is relative, but they don't follow the parent like a traditional bone does. Instead, they mostly follow a target bone. Now, I say mostly because they are actually affected by the parent's movements once we get into additive animations, as we'll see later in this episode. Let's look at how virtual bones are typically configured, as I'll be adding them to my character here. I'm using an ALS character, which is based on the UE4 skeleton, but you can easily follow along with any other humanoid. Virtual bones can be used with and without weapon bones, but I'll be covering both cases. If you don't know what weapon bones are, I have a previous video that covers them well. Now, I'll be using multiple sets of virtual bones here to explain the differences in the various ways virtual bones are typically used, but you'll only need one set for your game. Now, if you're not using weapon bones, there are two main approaches. The first way is to add the virtual bones to the root and then following the limbs, either the hands or feet. This is how you often see it done in most tutorials and the official Unreal documentation. The other way is to attach it to one hand, but following the other hand. This is how you see it in Lyra and ALS. The difference is whether you want to use the parent bone's movements to affect the virtual bones on top of the target bone's movement. Now, for projects where you are using weapon bones and have two-handed weapons, it's important that you parent the virtual bone to the weapon bone and then follow the opposite hand, as we want the virtual bone to follow the movements of the apparent weapon in these cases. Now let's look at how virtual bones move. When I first saw virtual bones and how they just follow the target bone in simple cases, I couldn't understand the point of them, but things are not quite that simple that they simply follow the target. You won't notice this when you're playing a single animation, and it will seem like the weapon bone only really cares about the position of the target, but once we start combining animations, it becomes more important. I've here taken the default ALS character and changed its virtual bones to have three types: root to hand, hand to hand, and weapon bone to hand, as we can see here. I then took some simple one-frame pose animations affecting the left hand and combined them in different ways. Note that no part of playing animations actually cares about actual motion outside of physical animation, so we can build an understanding from single frames. We can see that when we're using single animation slash poses like this, the root to left hand virtual bone here just tracks the target bone perfectly. But if we do a simple blend between two animations, we can see that the virtual bone no longer follows the target, and it ends up being at the wrist here. So why is that? This happens because the virtual bone don't exactly follow the target bone, but rather it applies the offset of the target bone relative to the parent. So if we look at an overlaid side view here, we can see that the base pose, the bent arm pose, and the blend. And we can see that the final offset of the virtual bone is just an even blend between those two offsets. Now let's try combining the animations with additive instead of blending. So we take the entirety of the bent arm pose and apply it to the base pose, resulting in what would be the bent pose itself. And then we get the full virtual bone offset added to the base pose offset. So we can imagine the virtual bone first being placed at the base pose's offset here, and then we add from there the additive animation's offset. The additive's offset get added on top, which just happens to line up with the hand bone here. The reason things align up is because the parent bone is not moving, so the two offsets exist in the same space, so to speak. Now let's take the bent pose and use it as our base pose, and then add the same bent pose on top. We now end up with a hand pointing upwards, as we basically rotated the forearm 90 degrees twice. But now the virtual bone doesn't end up at the position of the hand. Remember, we are applying a simple offset to the virtual bone, not a relative rotation in a chain of joints, which is what the arm is experiencing. On the side view, we can see our bent pose starting point, and we can see the size of the offset to the bent additive pose from the base pose to which the additive is relative. We can then apply that offset to the starting point, and we get a resulting position in front of the character. In these cases, the hand-to-hand and weapon-to-hand virtual bones also behave the exact same as the root-to-hand virtual bone. This is because for all these three types of virtual bones, the parent doesn't move at all, and in those cases we end up with the same result. But if the parents are moving, we get different results, as we'll see later. Now we've been looking at the root-to-left-hand virtual bone. Now I want to look at the exact same poses we have used, but focus on the left to right hand virtual bone. Here we can see that the bone is not aligned with the right hand for a blended pose, even though the right hand has not moved at all. This is because from this perspective, the parent of the virtual bone has moved, not the target, changing the space in which the offset is added. We can look at the front and side view of this situation, for both the bent, blended, and base pose. Now, understanding why it ends up exactly here took me quite a long time to figure out. If we look closely, it doesn't seem to be an even blend between the two offsets, like I expected. We can see that the angle is far too shallow for that. But the explanation ends up being that we're changing the frame of reference, not just the position in world space, but also in rotation. So the offset of the bent pose is relative to the rotation of the hand. So basically the virtual bone is in the direction of the palm, but rotated slightly towards the elbow if you look. Then when we blend, the hand has rotated significantly, but the offset is still in the direction of the palm rotated towards the elbow, times 0.5 in this case, since we're blending. For additive, we end up with the full direction of the palm but rotated towards the elbow, not just half like the blend case. So in conclusion, virtual bones follow the target bone's offset in global space, but also changes the reference in which we apply that offset in both translational and rotational space. You don't necessarily need to understand all this just to use virtual bones, but I find it helpful to have this fundamental understanding when things don't behave exactly the way I expect. Now that we've seen how it behaves in very basic cases, let's look at actual animations. I here have a breathing animation in my animation blueprint, and we can see that it follows the target bone exactly, as will be the case with any single animation. In this animation, the hands move perfectly in sync, including not moving towards or away from each other. So the relative transform from one to the other is basically static. Though when we look at the left to right hand virtual bone, we see a tiny bit of jitter due to floating point error, but that will be imperceptible in reality. The virtual bone parented to the weapon bone behave like the hand to hand virtual bones. Now let's do something more interesting with our animation blueprint. We'll take a base pose, here a rifle pose, but it could also be an animation. And then we'll add our idle breathing animation to make it look more natural. Right away we can see that this causes some issues with the hands not aligning correctly. This is known as swimming, and fixing that is one of the most common use cases for virtual bones. It happens because our breathing animation moves the arms in a specific posture, and now when we add some relative rotations from the additive animation that has been made relative to some other pose, the end result for each arm does not end up being in sync for the hand movements, like we had with the breathing in isolation. Each hand now moves in a different reference frame, which is the result of a chain of reference frames. This is just one of the quirks of how rotation propagates through a chain of joints. And it's also the reason we have to deal with things like gimbal locks and quaternions. But if we look at the virtual bones, they get affected differently, because the way virtual bones are affected by additive animations is not through a chain of joints, but a much simpler translation into space of the parent bone. So in this case, if we could get the left hand to behave like the virtual bone, we can avoid the swimming issue entirely. And the way to do that is using IK. So what we're gonna do is simply move the hand to where the virtual bone is. We can do this straight in the animation graph with the to bone IK node. We then have to select the IK bone, which is the bone we want to move, the hand in this case. The effector is where we want the bone to go, which is gonna be in bone space, and we can choose our virtual bone. This way we've drastically reduced the swimming issue. You might notice though that the result is not quite perfect, as the left hand is still sliding a little bit on the handle. And if we look at the movements of the left hand bone and the virtual bone, we can see that the hand bone isn't actually following the virtual bone all that well. I'm not sure why this happens, but it has something to do with the two bone IK node. It's also worth noting that these nodes only adjust the location and not the rotation of the virtual bone. But instead, if we use control rig, we can get much better results. I won't cover how control rigs work in general in detail here, but it's useful for modifying your animations dynamically at runtime, with, for example, inverse kinematics. So here we have a basic IK node, very similar to the two-bone IK node we saw in the animation blueprint. It takes the joints up to the hand and adjusts the transform of the effector, where I've chosen it to be the virtual bone we're using. There are some extra settings further down that help choose the elbow position. But let's go back to the animation blueprint with the control rig we just saw, and we'll get much better results. Now, let's try to have it follow the root to left hand virtual bone instead. And now we see we have some swimming again. So why is that? If we look at the idle pose in isolation again, try to carefully notice how much the left hand is swaying compared to the root movement in global space. It's not actually all that much. Then if we look at it as an additive again, we can see that the root to left hand virtual bone sways by that same amount, and due to our inverse kinematics, the left hand does the same. So what is the right hand even doing? Well, because of how these motions add up through a series of joints and from a new orientation, we end up with even more swaying. So to fix our swimming again, we also have to add our IK to the right hand. And we end up with the swimming issue fixed again, but now with less swaying of the hands compared to our original method of solving it. This solution here is only possible because we have an additive animations where both hands are moving perfectly in sync with each other in the global space from the perspective of the root. Now if we make a new idle animation, here I've taken the original idle animation and added some extra jitter to the left hand only. This model will actually break. If you have additive animations where the hands in this case are not synchronized, then we have to get more aggressive with how we use virtual bones and ensure that the additive animation doesn't affect the virtual bones at all. We can do this with layered blend per bone, and is often how you see virtual bones used. It would be nice if we could use a branch filter to select just the virtual bones, but that's actually the inverse of what we want. We want to exclude the virtual bones. So to do that, we can use a blend mask, which is like a more detailed filter. We have to go into the skeleton and define this blend mask to be able to exclude virtual bones like I'm doing here. Layered blend per bone with blend masks have a number of uses I might cover in the future. Now we resolve the swimming issue, even with our non-synchronized additive animation. But we ask the additive animation to not move the virtual bone, and the base pose is static, so why are the virtual bones still swaying? That's because we're using the hand-to-hand virtual bones here, and while the offset is indeed not changing relative to the parent bones are still moving, which will move the virtual bone along with them, causing this motion. This is where one of the big differences comes in, when you have to choose whether to parent your virtual bones to the root or the other hand. As the root solution, we get no movement at all in this case. Alright, now I hope you have a better understanding of how virtual bones behave in general. Virtual bones, of course, applies to more than just hands on rifles, or on spears like in my game War Tribes, but can also be used for a number of additional use cases. I'll list a handful here, but I won't go into details with them as that's beyond the scope of this video. There are uses for virtual bones for foot IK as an alternative to using IK bones for this. You may see cases where virtual bones are parented to a hand and then following an IK bone. This can be helpful in cases where you have additive or control rig movement affecting the placement of your hand, causing the IK bone to no longer be aligned with the hand. When using virtual bones here, the virtual bones will be offset, the same offset as the hand, ensuring that your gun follows your hand. The virtual bone will also be offset by that same amount as the hand, ensuring that the gun that will be attached to the IK bone will follow your hand perfectly. A final use of virtual bones that I want to mention is using them like sockets, but we can have procedural movement added on top. For example, if you have a weapon attached to the back of your character, you can give the virtual bone some springy motion from control rig to make it look more natural, without requiring actually including that as part of your animation. Virtual bones took me a long time to understand, so don't feel bad if you have to rewatch this video a couple times, and maybe even look at external resources. But I hope this video has been at least somewhat helpful in understanding what virtual bones are and how they're used. It is my goal to always bring you straight to the point and useful tutorials. If you like what you see, hit like and subscribe. And if you want to see more of me develop my top-down skill-based tribal management game, check out the main channel. Thank you for watching.